In this example, we'll take a look at a process costing environment. The following information is available for the molding department of RTA distributors for January. Beginning work in process, 4,000 units, 30% complete as to conversion costs. Started this month, 6,000 units, transferred to assembly, 7,000 units. Ending work in process, 3,000 units. So here we have the molding department that worked on some inventory and completed some of it that they transferred to the next department, which apparently is the assembly department. Recall that conversion costs are direct labor and overhead costs combined. Costs associated with beginning work in process, direct materials, $2,500, conversion cost, $1,000. Cost added during the month, direct materials, $5,000, conversion costs, $7,500. All materials are added at the beginning of the process. Now, this last statement, what that tells us is that work in process inventory is 100% complete as to materials. If you see this statement in a problem, then this is what you can assume. And it's a very common thing for them to have to add the materials at the beginning and then work on that and add the labor and overhead continuously. All right, now it will be helpful if you will take sort of a big picture look at this before we start the computations. If you add the beginning costs up, we have $3,500 of beginning costs. Currently, we added $12,500, so we have $16,000 of total cost in this problem. Our goal is to allocate that among the partially completed units and the completed units. So we will be taking the $16,000 and assigning some of the cost to the 3,000 units of ending work in process and some of the cost to the 7,000 units completed. Now note that we cannot divide by 10,000 units because some of them are partway finished and more cost will be added to complete them. Prepare a production cost report and do the following. Calculate the cost per equivalent unit. Allocate cost among units in ending work in process and units completed in the molding department and transferred to the assembly department for January. Reconcile the costs to be accounted for and the costs accounted for. So steps 1, 2, and 3 here essentially are what you do when you prepare a production cost report. So they could have just simply said, prepare a production cost report, and you would automatically know to do these things. The first thing we'll do is account for the physical flow of units. If you'll remember, that formula was beginning work in process plus units started equal ending work in process plus units completed. We were given that beginning work in process was 4,000 units, 30% complete as to conversion costs, but here we are going to look at whole units, not equivalent units. So we began with 4,000 units, and then during the month of January, we started 6,000 more. This tells management that we worked on 10,000 units. Of those 10,000 units, 3,000 are still being worked on since they are an ending work in process, and 7,000 are finished. Now, in this problem, we didn't necessarily have to summarize this for management, but there are situations where one of these items is left unknown and you have to solve for it. So I have students ask, when do we know that we need to do step one? And I'll give you the teacher answer and say, do it if you have enough information to do so. Next, we'll accumulate costs. All right, in the weighted average method, you want to average all costs over all work done. So you will have beginning cost plus current cost in this calculation. Notice that I've set up two columns. That's because our ending work in process is 100% complete as to materials, but only 50% complete as to conversion costs. So I know, because I had two percentages completion in ending work in process, I know that I need two columns. All right, our beginning costs, you can see we're given to be $2,500 for materials and $1,000 for conversion costs. Then currently we added $5,000 of materials and $7,500 of conversion costs. So our total costs are $7,500 worth of materials and $8,500 of conversion costs. Next, we'll calculate the equivalent units. So step two gets our numerator, cost. Step three, we calculate our denominator, our equivalent units. Once again, you see that I have two columns set up. Because we included all costs, we want to include all work done. So we'll start with the units completed. That would be the number transferred to assembly. That means they were completed in the molding department. And 7,000 will go under the materials column and the conversion cost column. Because remember, every unit must be assigned materials and labor and overhead cost. Next, we'll add ending work in process equivalent units. For materials, these 3,000 units are 100% complete. For labor and overhead, they're only 50% complete. So we'll add 3,000 in the materials column and 1,500 in the conversion costs column. This will give us total equivalent units of 10,000 for materials and 8,500 for conversion costs. You should now see why we needed two columns. We have a different denominator for materials than we do for conversion costs. Now, when you look at this, you may ask, what about the beginning work in process? Well, we have included the beginning work in process because in these types of manufacturing situations, these are the first units completed. These 4,000 units were the first ones that were completed within the 7,000 units completed. So we have included them. In fact, if you were using FIFO, you would have to take them out so that you could have a beginning and a current layer. But we're not using FIFO. All right, step four makes a lot of sense now. We're going to calculate the cost per equivalent unit. So for materials, that total cost divided by total equivalent units will be $7,500 and $8,500 for conversion costs. The equivalent units, 10,000 for materials, 8,500 for conversion costs. So our cost per equivalent unit for materials is 75 cents and conversion cost is a dollar. That means our total cost per equivalent unit is $1.75. So a finished unit in this production run costs $1.75. Now we'll use this calculation and we'll value our inventories. Now remember, we're trying to value the 7,000 units completed and the 3,000 units partially completed. First, let's value the completed units. Those are the ones that are transferred to the assembly department. There were 7,000 units. The cost of a finished unit in this production run was calculated to be $1.75. So the 7,000 units completed in the molding department will be assigned a value of $12,250. The work in process was made up of 3,000 units that were 100% complete as to materials, but only 50% complete as to conversion costs. So we will need to value the equivalent units of production. For materials, that's 3,000 units that were 100% complete, or 3,000 equivalent units that costed $0.75 each, or $2,250 of materials. These 3,000 units that were 50% complete as to conversion cost will translate to be 1,500 equivalent units that each cost a dollar, or $1,500 of conversion cost will be assigned to the units. The total value of our ending work in process then is $3,750. Now be careful here on the ending work in process. You are valuing equivalent units of production since they are not fully completed. And as a final step, we'll reconcile costs. That is, we'll summarize the cost incurred and where they were assigned for management. If you'll recall from your notes, the formula is beginning costs plus current cost equal the value of ending work in process plus the value of the units transferred or units completed. For us, our beginning costs totaled $3,500. You can look back at the information provided and see that materials, labor, and overhead combined was $3,500. For the current cost, materials, labor, and overhead added was $12,500. We calculated the value of our inventories to be $3,750 for ending work in process and $12,250 that was transferred to the assembly department. Now, this provides a summary to management, but for us, it does provide a way to check your work because this equation, of course, should balance. And we see that $16,000 is the total cost incurred, and we see that $16,000 is the total cost assigned to inventories. This will be true as long as there's not a rounding error. So this does check out, and that always makes you happy. All right, it is time for you to get some practice. With practice, this does make a lot more sense, so be sure to do that and ask questions if you have them.